and welcome to the Presto Music Podcast. Post-war America was undoubtedly a heady time, and no more so than in the world of orchestral music, an era where conductors regularly made the cover of Time magazine, orchestral reputations were being made and broken, and dynasties were being forged. At a time when performances were increasingly being recorded and disseminated for the masses on long-playing records. These LPs are now, of course, finding a new and remastered home on CD, and three conductors in particular, Artur Rodzinski in New York, Rafael Kubelik in Chicago, and Eugene Ormandy in Philadelphia, are among the latest to be boxed up. There's nobody better to discuss these recordings with than someone who, though he wasn't quite around at the time, nonetheless has probably forgotten about more records than I've ever heard, and is already now making a hat-trick of appearances on the Presto Music Podcast. Welcome back, Rob Cowan.
Thank you very much, Paul, and delighted to be here.
The first of our triumvirate is the Polish Artur Rodzinski, whose recordings for the Columbia label, mostly with the New York Philharmonic, have now found a new home in a Sony box set. Rob, can you introduce the career of Artur Rodzinski, orchestra builder?
Well, that's his main claim to fame, to be absolutely honest, that he built the NBC Symphony Orchestra for Toscanini. Toscanini gave his first concert with them on Christmas Eve in 1937, and various other conductors, including Stokowski and Eric Kleiber, conducted them. They were a marvellous, marvellous band, and I think that this was Rodzinski's great claim to fame, more as an orchestral trainer and a virtuoso conductor than as a subtle musician, which, to be absolutely honest, he wasn't. But this set is of his recordings, the Sony recordings with the New York Philharmonic Orchestra. He also recorded with the Cleveland Orchestra before Zell. It's very important to remember that although Zell obviously trained them to a tremendous standard of execution, Rodzinski also got marvellous results from them. And the New York Philharmonic legacy, I think, is probably the most impressive segment of his recorded output.
Yes, he created a foundation in both Cleveland and Chicago for George Sell in Cleveland and Fritz Reiner in Chicago.
Yeah, absolutely.
And you've got the first excerpt that you'd like to share?
I have. Well, when I first heard this recording of the William Tell Overture, I was convinced that it was the version that's used at the start of the Lone Ranger cowboy series on television. Of course, you're too young to remember that. But I was an addict when I was a kid of the Lone Ranger. And I thought, this has got to... Well, actually, it's not. That was a studio orchestra. But it's so fast and so brilliant. The interesting thing about it is if you... listen to recordings by Toscanini of the same piece, he's nowhere near as fast as Rodzinski. Much more of a bounce, much more elegant, much more like a gallop, whereas Rodzinski absolutely goes hell for leather. It's incredibly exciting.
Yes, you mentioned the Lone Ranger there, Rob. To me, this sounds more like a steam train than a horse.
Well, my wife, when I said, Georgie, you've got to listen to this, and I put it on, and she looked at me and said, you're joking. They've got to be playing that at the wrong speed, which a lot of people would think they were. You know, the record was playing at the wrong speed. But it's brilliant. And that was from an album of orchestral favourites. So there were two albums that he did of sort of twilight concerts, and that opened one of them. And the whole set, I think, it gives you a very, very good idea of what Rodzinski was like in both small pieces and large-scale works. And he had a great sense of structure. You know, he did the Brahms symphonies, not all of them with the New York Philharmonic, but the first two, which Toscanini was particularly fine in. And you can tell where that training came from, where that approach originated, if you like, in terms of the American musicians. So Rodzinski very much liked Toscanini in the way he viewed Brahms.
This is quite sort of an American approach to orchestral virtuosity, isn't it? They really loved really putting their orchestras through their paces.
That's right. And it's also musically very straightforward. You know, the thing about the Brahms second, which I listened to again last night, is that there are very few bends in the line, has a wonderful sense of line, very lyrical, very dramatic in the last movement, and the clarity and the balancing is immaculate. And this was something that Rodzinski was particularly good at, getting everything to sound, all the contrapuntal lines coming through without any disturbance from other instruments, if you like.
Well, for my pick from this set, I've picked an excerpt from Prokofiev's Fifth Symphony, which at the time, of course, was very much contemporary music. Here's the Andante First Movement. Personally, I found Rodzinski's quite hard-driven style, I think, actually more effective here in the Prokofiev. The music is perhaps more mechanistic, shall we say, than the Rossini. Do you feel that certain leadership styles from conductors lend themselves to different repertoire?
Absolutely right. That's true. Mind you, different repertoire lends itself to differing approaches from various conductors. So we're talking about Brahms. You've got people like Furtwängler, Klemperer, Mengelberg, and indeed Rodzinski and Toscanini. They were all entirely unalike. In Prokofiev, it's very, very interesting because on the one hand, you've got this pile-driving approach that you get from Rodzinski on this performance, and you've got somebody like Celibidache, who I heard do the symphony in London in the 1970s, who has great breadth, brings an epic grandeur to the piece, and that's entirely different. And the Russians, people like Rozhestvensky as well, all very different, all bringing out different aspects of the music. But Rodzinski, I think, makes it sound almost filmic, which is interesting.
Which is very appropriate for Prokofiev.
It very appropriate for Prokofiev, given his film scores that he wrote. So, yeah, it's impressive.
You could perhaps say that the strength of the music lies within its ability to be interpreted in a variety of different ways. Brahms music is so great because it is able to be interpreted in so many different ways.
Yeah, the greater the music, the greater the potential for interpretative variety, I think.
Absolutely. Well, Rodzinski stormed out of New York in 1947 to Chicago for yet another mere 3-year stint and was replaced in Chicago by the great Czech conductor Rafael Kubelik, who himself only spent 3 years in the post. Fortunately, in that time, making an outstanding series of recordings for the Mercury label, now boxed up on Eloquence and released on the 11th of June. Rob, why was his time in Chicago cut short?
Well, there was a notorious critic, Claudia Cassidy, who absolutely loathed Kubelik's work and took every opportunity to have a go at him in the press. Basically, what the trustees of the orchestra, and they were responsible for getting rid of him, objected to were his performances of modern music. Not the performances of modern music, but the fact that he selected contemporary music, or what was contemporary in the day, and they objected to that. But they wanted the greatest hit syndrome, you know, to and it would have been quite popular today with certain in certain quarters. But that was why. And he was a brave, you know, the thing about Kubelik, he was a pioneer, and he was a very brave man, you know, who stood against political oppression, both the Nazis and the communists. He refused to go back to communist Czechoslovakia post just after the war. He came and settled over here, and then, of course, he'd settled in America, eventually in Switzerland, conducting the Bavarian Radio Symphony Orchestra in Munich. And you know, he was somebody, he was a creative person himself. He wrote some very impressive orchestral works, some of which have been recorded under his own baton. And you know, everything Kubelik does has that sort of ease of passage about it. I always think of him as a sort of a latter-day Ford Wengler, you know, simply because he is a man who knows the music from the inside. You know, you feel that he understands the process of composition, and everything you hear has that knowledge, foreknowledge, if you like, when it comes to certain works that we don't know, like the Bloch Concerto Grosso No. 1, for example, which to me is the most glorious piece, very rarely heard. And if you think in terms of neoclassical works by Martineau and Stravinsky that were being written around about that time, this is such a joyful work. And Kubelik's Chicago recording, I've got a test pressing, a test LP pressing, which I got off a collector many years ago, and I've treasured it, and I'm absolutely delighted to see this particular recording come into this set. And not only the complete performance, there's also a run-through of some of it as well, so you get extra value in an interpretation which is among Kubelik's greatest in Chicago.
Yes, I was absolutely delighted to see this recording in this set. Let's sample the opening prelude. Ernest Bloch's Concerto Grosso, performed by the Chicago Symphony Orchestra, conducted by Rafael Kubelik. Yeah, as you said, it's a wonderful piece, Rob. It's remarkably expressive for a piece of neoclassicism, isn't it?
It certainly is, and the emotional clout that it has is actually quite remarkable. You know, not everything of Bloch is quite as instantly appealing as that is, but that, I think, and the Violin Concerto are the two masterpieces that we can really appreciate very easily.
You know, critics seem much more comfortable being critical, and perhaps they do now. There's an article of Time magazine that simply labelled Rodzinski as not a great conductor, with no gift for fanning fire and excitement into his players. And as you've mentioned, Acidy Cassidy, hounding Kubelik out of Chicago. I can't imagine a critic having that much power now, Rob, as much as you might want it.
I would never want it. In fact, I having reviewed records for years, the last thing anybody wants to do is take any notice of me. I mean, what I want to do is guide people. And the thing is, you learn to read a critic. You learn to read their likes and their dislikes and their prejudices and their the things that they really love, so that they guide you through their own personalities and their own tastes to things that you think you will enjoy yourself. So, I don't think any critic would have that sort of power. And I don't think listeners are that stupid. The thing is that listeners are incredibly educated today in comparison with what they were like years ago. You know, you've had years of the gramophone, for example, which has been hugely educational since the 1920s, and other music magazines, and of course now with Wikipedia and all the various sites that you get up online, you can look up anything. You can spend a day reading about a particular performance by a particular conductor and still not exhaust what's available. So it's different. There's so many opportunities to educate yourself now. Educate yourself in music theory. You can educate yourself in score reading, anything. So I think the potential for learning is so much greater now, which I think gives more credence to what a critic says.
Mercury was at the forefront of recording technology in the early 50s, and included on this 10-CD set for the first time is a Mozart Prague symphony in experimental stereo. What is experimental stereo?
Well, it's basically binaural, which is a sort of two-channel, but it's not really set up to be stereo in the way that a proper stereo recording team would make it. But the results, particularly in Kubelik's recording of the Prague Symphony of Mozart, the chap called Bert White used to go around with his setup, stereo or binaural setup, all over America making these recordings, Stokowski and Kubelik and other people. And to be honest, Paul, you listen to this, and Reiner recorded Mozart symphonies in Chicago, for RCA Living Stereo. There's hardly any difference in terms of quality between this early Mercury recording in stereo or binaural and a Living Presence recording a Living Stereo recording that would have been made around about this, just a couple of years later. It's remarkable.
Quite surprising that they made them. I can't imagine there was many people who owned the required kit to get the best out of these recordings at the time. They were very much ahead of their time.
Well, that's a very good point. But mind you, Decca were recording stereo and binaural recordings long before stereo LPs were available. But if you listen to this, and it was years before stereo records came on the market, but you listen to this and, you know, done a brilliant job at eloquence transferring it, and you would never believe that it wasn't from about 1958-1959.
And should you wish to find out more about this remarkable series of Mercury recordings, then a new podcast hosted by Charlotte Gardner from the Gramophone explores the production of these records, featuring interviews with Wilma Cozart Fine, who spearheaded their production, a link to which will be available on the podcast description.
I met Wilma, by the way.
Oh, really?
Yes. It was in the 90s, when the Mercury label was being launched on CD. And she was amazing because her voice, and you'll hear it on this podcast, it's incredible. It's so American. She sounds like she ought to have come off the Medium program or something like that. Such a character, and so lovely, and so totally dedicated to the cause of Mercury Living Presence, and an incredibly good producer.
Well, alongside Kubelik's Chicago recordings, his Decca recordings, mostly with the Vienna Philharmonic, have also been boxed up by eloquence. What are some of your highlights from the Decca set?
Well, the main recording there that I value is Marflust with the Vienna Philharmonic Orchestra, which has a performance of Sharka, about this sort of Amazon woman, that is probably the most thrilling movement from the cycle. It's the third piece, comes directly after Volteva. At the end of that is just utterly electrifying. Now, there are loads of Kubelik recordings of Marflust with various orchestras, the Boston Symphony, the Bavarian Radio Symphony Orchestra, and the Czech Philharmonic Orchestra. But, you know, all right, the sound is okay. It's a stereo recording, a little bit cavernous, but the brass, the way the orchestra goes for it, it's really led off the leash in a way that I don't think any other recording has been.
You can almost trace Kubelik's career through his recordings of Marflust, can't you?
You can.
From the early
can.
Chicago performance that's also in the Mercury Box, to the triumphant homecoming with the Czech Philharmonic after the fall of the Berlin Wall.
That's right. Yeah, absolutely. As for other things, I do like the Slavonic dances, not as much as I like the Bavarian Radio Symphony Orchestra performances, which have a little bit more swagger and exuberance, but they're beautifully played. There's a lovely new world, although the cor anglais at the beginning of the largo is a little bit recessed. You know, it gets better focus as it goes on. And the Israel Serenade for Strings, Israel Philharmonic Serenade for Strings, is very lovely as well. So I'd say there are some and the operas, of course, the Merry Wives of Windsor from Munich, and the Der Freischütz, which is so atmospheric I would say it's almost as good as the Carlos Kleiber. So it's a great set. It's a great set, I would say. Musically as distinctive as the Chicago set.
Yes, there's a wonderful Brahms cycle, which is really urgent, isn't it?
Yes, it is very urgent. And actually, if you compare that with the Munich recordings on Orfeo, it could be a different conductor, except that they're both very insightful. But as you say, there's the urgency to the Vienna Philharmonic set. Eloquence brought that set out on its own on two CDs, but it's better to have the whole kit and caboodle, the Kubelik and Decca, you know.
Absolutely agreed. Well, if our previous two conductorships were noticeable for their brevity, then Ormandy's extraordinary 44-year tenure at the Philadelphia is remarkable for its length. What are some of the key characteristics of the Stokowski sound that he inherited and preserved on Sony's remarkable 120-CD set of his complete mono recordings recorded between 1944 and 1958?
Where do I go with this? I looked at this and I thought, apart from that, that I had to actually do a workout before accepting it through the door. It's so incredibly heavy. But once I opened it, and the great thing about this set is that so many of the recordings have either never been issued here before on LP or CD, or never been on CD. And the interesting thing about Ormandy, who was Blau was his original name. He was a violinist. He recorded as a violinist. He was conductor of the Minneapolis Symphony Orchestra, as it was in the 1930s, and then later on he came over, co-conducted the Philadelphia with Stokowski. But this idea that he inherited the Stokowski sound and just left it as it was is simply inaccurate. It's very interesting. There's another case which is quite similar of the Concertgebouw under Willem Mengelberg, when Edward von Beinum came in to the Concertgebouw. He did the sort of things with the orchestra that Ormandy did with the Philadelphia Orchestra. In other words, Mengelberg used incredible portamenti. Von Beinum ironed a lot of those out. A lot of the, mannerisms, because there's nothing wrong with individuality, but some of the more extreme gestures were countered by a much straighter approach to the music. And the same with Ormandy. If you compare Ormandy's approach to certain works with Stokowski's, Stokowski used these swooping portamenti, so extreme. The Tchaikovsky Fifth, for example, this yawning. I mean, it's beautiful in its way because he got the orchestra, Stokowski, to play so magnificently, but it can be distracting for people who are not used to it.
Too much of a good thing, perhaps.
Too much of a good thing, yes, I think so. And although, as I say, I found myself going back to them a lot. But Ormandy's performances have texture. They have richness of sound. They have intelligence. They have a sound. They have a sense of musical structure. They have clarity. And yet there is this luxuriance, which was exaggerated, I think, once he left the mono era and Columbia sort of edged him into the stereo era, where his laurels that he was resting on flowered so much he slept on them a bit. I think that in the mono era, the performances, I'm thinking particularly of the Brahms symphonies, are much more taut. They're no less expressive because he re-recorded all the Brahms symphonies in stereo. All the Brahms symphonies are also in the mono box. But a particularly beautiful performance, and thrilling as well in the last two movements, is the Fourth Symphony. That wonderful melody, this big string melody, its return, is sumptuous.
And you've got an excerpt from the slow movement. Yeah, I found a really strong sense of trajectory in this, but not necessarily rushed. I was also very impressed with the Brahms 3 in this set. It was really alive, I felt, to the emotional ebbs and flows in this symphony, so crucial to a good performance.
I couldn't agree more. He makes it sound like Brahms's Eroica. That opening, it's arresting. It brings you in. It flies you away. And that's what that music is about. So I think it's wonderful. I mean, there's so much repertoire that's interesting, especially the Americana. You get symphonies by Walter Piston, William Schumann. You get Victor Herbert, which is a real sort of socket to me production. I mean, that is major hi-fi, major mono hi-fi, the like of which you won't find, as impressive as any of the Mercury recordings. Also, I think Roy Harris, who's a sort of a Lone Ranger style composer, you can imagine him trotting across the prairies. He has this sense of space The only thing about Harris, and I love Harris's music, there are two symphonies, or three symphonies, the seventh, which we're going to hear a little bit of, there's the sixth, which is the Gettysburg, which is fabulous, and the third, of course, which is the most famous. But you do sometimes get a sense that all his symphonies revisit the third at one time or another, but it's still lovely, lovely music. The end of the seventh is particularly impressive.
Well, let's hear that now, performed by, of course, the Philadelphia Orchestra and conducted by Eugene Ormandy. Great shame that none of these American symphonies have really entered the repertoire. Why do you feel that might be the case?
I don't know. I suppose we've got our own symphonies, and a lot of those haven't entered the repertoire, the symphonies of Bax and Rubber and people like that. It's a very interesting question. I suppose the great symphonies that have entered the repertoire have got a sort of thematic distinction, and that's what makes them so appealing for people. You know, we were talking about my Flust before, and although it doesn't often get performed over here, it is so memorable. And the Harris third is memorable once you've played it about 70 times, but it is memorable. It's a lovely piece. And Sibelius is incredibly memorable, but there is a combination of thematic distinctiveness and atmosphere. And I think a lot of these other symphonies, they just fall short a little bit of that ideal.
Well, for my first selection from this set, I've picked a recording that highlights two things that we do readily associate with this orchestra: the connection to Sergei Rachmaninoff and Ormandy predecessor Stokowski's love of orchestral transcriptions. Here, Rachmaninoff's famous piano prelude, Opus 3, No. 2, is transmogrified into a miniature Gothic tone poem. Rob, a bit of a guilty pleasure for yourself as well?
Well, I will say, it's as camp as Chloe. There's no doubt about that. I mean, look, I love these things. I love some of the Bach transcriptions, not all of them, but I love people who do things with an outsized imagination. And that's actually an incredibly good transcription of its kind. It's Cahier, isn't it, who made that one? And Ormandy conducts it magnificently. So, no, not so guilty, actually. a pretty impressive choice. And as I say, there are other transcriptions throughout the set. I like the Hershey K Gottschalk suite. That's fantastic, which has got the banjo, which involves the orchestra, and I think two harps. Fantastic. And this is the thing. This is another thing. The element of journeying and discovering throughout the set, which is tremendous. You can hear, like the last Tchaikovsky symphonies, and Mozart. Now, who would have thought that Ormandy was would have turned out to be a great Haydn conductor. And in the Mozart 40th Symphony, in the last movement, he takes both repeats, which brings the playing time up to 9 minutes. Now, this is 1956. Can you find me another conductor who did that on disc? I can't find anybody or think of anybody. I'd be very glad if somebody told me of somebody.
Well, for my second pick, I've gone for Rimsky-Korsakov's Scheherazade. This piece really lends itself to the Philadelphia Orchestra's playing style, doesn't it?
Oh, absolutely. Largely because of the memories of Stokowski's magnificent performances, which are fairly similar. But Ormandy had this sense of orchestral colour. And, you know, there's a lovely quote in the booklet that, where Ormandy said that he wanted people to go out sort of whistling the tune of the last piece on the programme. And, of course, you know, there's nothing more tuneful in the repertory. There is a little website where you can get funny Ormandy quotes. said that Bizet's talking about Bizet's symphony in C, and says Bizet was very, very young when he wrote this piece, so play it quietly. And it's in the symphony in C is in the set, and fortunately, he doesn't play it quietly. It's a lovely poem. But Scheherazade, no, fantastic.
We definitely get the impression of Ormandy as a much more rounded musician in this set than we perhaps given him credit for before, don't we?
Definitely. And I think a lot is due to the fact that you get a much more dynamic conductor than you got later on, you know. I mean, even with the Brahms B-flat concerto with Rudolf Serkin, and Ormandy and Serkin were magnificent. They recorded the concerto three times, once in stereo, which is a very handsome production, and I would definitely recommend that as well. But the two previous ones are in the mono set, and they're marvellous. And I think people tend to underestimate just what an intelligent musician Ormandy was. Think he was just somebody who rolled out tunes in exaggerated garb, you know, soaked in string sonorities, and wasn't like that at all. Mind you, it wasn't true of Stokowski either. So I think that if you buy this set, and I was just thinking to myself, you know, how does it compare this set with the sets devoted to Toscanini, to Barbarolli, to Celibidache, and other people? And I think, in a way, it justifies the purchase even more than they do, because you learn so much more about Ormandy than you do about them through their discographies in mega sets.
Yeah, Ormandy has been something of a rediscovery in this set, and having previously dismissed him, I think, as someone who just, as I said in the beginning, inherited a great orchestra and an orchestral sound, do you feel critics have been unduly harsh on Ormandy as someone who excelled only in these lighter pieces, like the Transcriptions and Scheherazade?
I couldn't agree more. And I was guilty of this myself, you see, simply because I swallowed the critical opinions of, you know, oh, Ormandy, it'll be plush, it'll be, you know, it's not an intellectual experience. It's rubbish. It can be an intellectual experience. Look at Mahler 10. He was the first person to record Mahler 10, the Derek Cook performing version of Mahler 10. He did Mahler 2. He did Bruckner 5. So he did some pretty heavyweight, large scale. And the Bruckner 5 was marvellous. That was a stereo Sony recording. But now I think, you know, you accept the cliches and then suddenly you pick up a CD or a, like I did with one of the stereo Brahms performances. I think it was the fourth. And I came to the end of it and I thought, wow. You know, Sony have also brought out George Sell and Bruno Walter in this symphony, but this is equally as good. It's different. It's straighter. It's more along the lines of a Toscanini. But it's a pretty marvellous performance. Yes, I think he's been very, very... His art has been underplayed by critics. And I think somebody said, I can't remember where I read this, that, you know, the public love Ormandy... The critics hate him, and they hate him because he doesn't deliver what they love talking about. I think that is so true. There's not much to talk about with Ormandy, but there's a hell of a lot to listen to.
Yes, to me, it's a very good marriage between that beautiful sonority of the orchestra and a very direct, no-nonsense approach to interpretation. It's really quite actually a good combination.
I think it is, absolutely right. And... you always get the feeling he knows what he's doing. You feel you're in safe hands with Ormandy without him sort of cosseting you. And I think that's a valuable asset.
Yeah, and I would say, especially in what was at the time contemporary music, there's a really wonderful set of recordings of contemporary American composition in this set. With the Schumann Third, William Schumann, I should say.
Yes,
the Third
yes.
Symphony I was particularly impressed by as well.
Well, he's a bit like Harris, but a more cerebral composer than Harris was. And, yeah, absolutely. Prokofiev 6. Now, that must have been the first Western recording. I mean, I do correct me if I'm wrong, but there were three early recordings of Prok 6. There was Osame, there was Mravinsky, and there was Ormandy. And they're all marvellous in their very different ways. So, you know, you get that, you get... that sort of work included as well.
Perhaps in a way similar to sports teams, perhaps keeping an orchestra on top form for nearly 50 years is actually a greater achievement than making rapid improvements and then moving on, like Rodzinski. I'm sure that there are many parallels with leadership in all sorts of fields, and given that the results are so clearly audible, conductors provide a real insight into different styles of leadership and how leadership has changed over the years, don't they?
But let me say something, Paul, which I think is quite important. You're absolutely right, but the only reason that relationship between Ormandy and the orchestra, between Mravinsky and the Leningrad Philharmonic Orchestra, Zell and the Cleveland Orchestra, and Furtwängler and the Berlin Philharmonic, the only reason, and they were all demanding conductors, that the relationship survived was because these were great musicians and they were loved and respected by their players. To be honest, as much as I love the respect the Rodzinski set, it's incredibly exciting. I don't know whether he could have sustained a relationship with an orchestra for 44 years because his musical ingredients, if you like, weren't rich enough to sustain it. Whereas somebody like Toscanini or Zell or Ormandy, or I could quote Celibidache, you know, mind you, he didn't stay very long with anybody, but, you know, they all had those qualities and you could keep on rediscovering the music through them because of their wisdom as musicians.
Of course, and well, thanks to the wisdom of people like yourself, Rob, it gives us the opportunity to rediscover these great performances and interpretations. Thank you very much again for your inexhaustible knowledge of recordings.
Oh, that's very kind of you, Paul, and thank you so much. Thank you so much.
And we hope you'll be back on the podcast just when there's another great big batch of sets to go through. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for your time. Thanks to Matt Green for producing, and thanks to you for listening.